overflows my soul. Something happened. How I knew he touched me and made me whole. Since I met this blessed Savior, since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls. He touched me. Something happened. Now I know he touched me and made me. Something happened. Now I know he touched me and
Good morning. My name is Jacob Hunter, and I'm the pastor at Industry United Methodist Church in Industry, Texas. On behalf of our congregation, I welcome you to this time of worship this morning. If you would, please join us as our praise team sings the opening song, Trading My Sorrows. Here they are. As we continue in worship this morning, will you please join me in an attitude of prayer as I pray the opening prayer. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, how shall we do your will today? Will it be in acts of praise, in gifts shared, in prayers lifted? Who will you lead us to serve? Help us trust you. Help us listen. Bless this community as we come together in worship. Encourage us, comfort us, unite us, make our joy complete. Amen. I now invite you to take a couple of moments to center your hearts and minds as members of our praise team sing Sanctuary before our gospel reading.
Lord, please make me a sanctuary, your hand holy, tried and true for you, and with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
Will you once again join me in an attitude of prayer as I pray the prayer for illumination? O great Spirit, move among us, within us, and around us if necessary, that your kingdom might come and your will be done according to your living word this day. Amen. This morning we have Frank Parker who will be reading our scripture reading.
Our gospel today comes from Matthew 21, verses 23 through 32. When he entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another. "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we're afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things." And then the next reading from our gospel this morning is also Matthew, and it's the parable of the two sons. "What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir,' but he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you so much. As we start this morning, I'd like to admit to something. As I did research, I found out that this phrase has been with us for much longer than I thought it has. But more recently in our news and in our current society, the phrase gotcha question has come up more and more. I had never heard that before, but as I read about it, that's what we have here today. The Pharisees, the leaders of the temple, the scribes, they are asking Jesus a gotcha question, a question that there is no right answer, and they're trying to trap him into answering how they want him to. The question is, by what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority? Doing these things. The question might be in your head, what things are they upset about Jesus doing? Well, our passage picks up in chapter 21 on verse 23. But chapter 21 starts with this. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. It goes on to tell a story about Jesus riding a donkey into Jerusalem while crowds shouted, Hosanna! Hosanna! Which translated, which means, save us, please, save us. This can't be good for the leaders of the temple. All of these people are on the street and they're shouting, please save us! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of God, please save us! So this must be what the chief priests and the elders must have been talking about, right? Or maybe, if we go on in chapter 21, verse 12 says this. Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple, and he overturned the tables of money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. Jesus goes into the temple and causes a disruption. A scene when he turns over tables and runs out all the people who are selling and trading money. My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers, he says. Then he heals someone in the temple, and then after that, he goes to Bethany and spends the night. The next morning, Jesus makes his way back to the temple. On the way, he curses a fig tree, and then our passage picks up. That's where we start today, with the gotcha question. So after all of those things which were upsetting the authorities of the temple, and they were looking for a reason already to get Jesus, this seemed like the perfect opportunity to trip him up. When they asked him this, they were hoping he would answer, because one of two things was going to happen. One, if he claims his own authority, according to Warren Carter, he admits to having no institutional or cultural legitimation and appears to have acted against God's purpose and certainly against their purpose. Or two, if he says God's authority, Warren says he blasphemes and violates their jurisdiction. They are looking for anything, any reason at this point to trip up Jesus, to trick him, to get him to answer how they wanted him to. But the funny thing is that by asking the question, they are at least acknowledging that he does have some authority. They just don't know where he gets that authority. One writer I read points out, the leaders have been asking this same question numerous of times in the gospel. They don't know, they don't question what he is doing. They are questioning how he's doing it. How is Jesus healing people? How is Jesus coming and teaching this new teaching? How is Jesus doing all of the things that he does? Many of them making them look bad. You see, the leaders of the temple, they have authority. But then the question is, who gave them authority? How did they get authority? They don't like that Jesus has challenged them and the way that he does things. This week, as I was reading, I saw several writers ask the question, indeed, the chief priests, scribes, and elders all have authority. But where did their authority come from? Well, the chief priests, they're born into that position. It's a birthright. It's a lineage thing. The scribes, they're trained in that position. They're educated. They're taught, which means they are probably a little bit better off than most of the people in that area. And the elders, well, the elders in the temple, they're wealthy, and they usually had political alliances. They are the ones that basically probably financed the temple and the activities that went on. See, the leaders of the temple are being challenged by Jesus. From time to time, he comes at them and says things to them and tries to teach them and challenges their authority sometimes. And they don't like it. But can you blame them? For years, for a long time, they have status. They have prestige. They are the top people in Jerusalem. They've got connections. They're living the good life. And Jesus is getting a group of people together, teaching them about God's love, and challenging these leaders and saying what they're doing is not true worship of God. So after the Palm Sunday entrance and him disrupting the temple, they have finally had enough. Verse 15 sums it up best. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the amazing things that he did and heard the children crying out in the temple, "Hosanna to the Son of David!" they became angry. Three words. They became angry. The light wasn't shining on them. The focus wasn't on them. Jesus was now the main attraction. And they became angry. They are afraid of many things. And Jesus is a challenge that could prove to be enough to provoke Rome to act out against the Jews. And they can't have that. So Jesus, when he's asked the question, he doesn't even answer it. He knows it's a trap. He knows they're trying to get him. He knows it's a gotcha question. So he counters with another question. And he says if they will answer his question, he will answer theirs. His question was, did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? Well, he asked the question, and then they all kind of huddle up, and they're like, well, what do we say? What do we do? How are we going to answer this? And as they're discussing it, they come to two conclusions. They come to one conclusion, which is, if they say heaven, Jesus will say, well, why didn't you believe him? If you believe his authority came from heaven to do baptism, why didn't you believe him and follow him? And if they say human, well, they're afraid of the crowd, because the entire crowd regarded John as a prophet. They're afraid of the crowd. They're afraid that the crowd would turn on them and take what they have. So they can't say heaven and they can't say human. So they say to Jesus, we don't know. It's the easy way out. They don't have to come to a conclusion. There's no consensus other than we don't know. Now, not being there, I would bet it was the best answer to the situation, because I know you never want a mob to turn on you. You don't want a big crowd to turn on you because you challenge something they believe. So Jesus does not answer the question either. He doesn't take their bait. He doesn't fall into their trap. He doesn't answer the question. Instead, Jesus closes with a parable. And in that parable, he tells a parable, he asks a question, and then he makes a statement. He starts, a man had two sons and he wanted them to work in the vineyard. So he goes to the first one, and the first one says, I will not go out and work. But later he changes his mind and he does go out into the field, the vineyard, and work. The second one When the father comes to him and asks him to go out into the vineyard, he says, I will go. And then he probably stays home playing his Nintendo or his Xbox, and he just ignores what his father asked him. Jesus then asks, which of these two did the will of the father? Well, this time they had an answer. This time they were ready. They were going to try to say something to Jesus and see what he came back with. So they answer, the first one. The first one is the one who did the will of the Father. Then Jesus makes a statement that must have not made them happy. I can't imagine them enjoying hearing this. He says, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw, you did not change your minds, and you did not believe him. Now, I know that sounds bad. Jesus is telling the most religious people in Jerusalem that before they get to heaven, sinners and prostitutes are going to be there first. But I do want to point out, Jesus never says they're not going to be in the kingdom of heaven. He just says that the others will be there before them. And we know that this is true because we know that Jesus does say that other people will not be in the kingdom of heaven. There are many, many of his parables and stories that end with, they will be thrown out and there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I am almost certain that that stuff, the weeping and gnashing of teeth, is not part of the kingdom of heaven. So here we see they're going to make it to the kingdom of heaven, but others will be going before them. It can't be settling for them to hear that news. And so this parable, this passage, is the beginning of Holy Week. But we're not in Holy Week, so we won't go all the way through. But we know the end game. We know the story. But what is the takeaway for today? What should we leave this time together knowing? I think that the writer Douglas Hare sums it up best. Douglas Hare says, although the context applies this parable of judgment to Jewish religious leaders, Matthew probably intended a wider application as well. Christians too can become blind to what God is doing in the world around them. How easily church work denigrates into little more than simply maintaining the institution with no excitement concerning what God's active grace is doing, and consequently no enthusiasm for evangelism and renewal. We say that we are going to work in the vineyard, but instead of harvesting the grapes, we spend our time rearranging the stones along the path. What is our takeaway? Our takeaway is, let's never let church work become only about maintaining an institution, but always looking with excitement for what God is doing in and around us in the bigger world, and not just what is happening in the walls of our sanctuaries, but everywhere. And always, always have enthusiasm for evangelism and renewal. Always. Our takeaway should be that when we say we're going to work in the vineyard, that we not get sidetracked with the stuff, but actually spend time harvesting grapes wherever we find them, not just in the walls of our church. Amen. Our next song this morning is from members of the praise team. They'll be singing Seek Ye First. Here they are.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Alleluia, alleluia. All things shall be added unto you. Seek and ye shall find.
We now come to that time in our worship service in which we pause and we lift up the concerns and joys that are on our hearts and minds to the Lord. I will share a few joys and concerns with you, and then I will give you a moment to lift yours, and then I will pray the pastoral prayer. This morning we continue like we have been, praying for all of the people around the world, especially in our country and around here, who've suffered with COVID-19. We continue to pray for world leaders and our country's leaders and our state leaders as they continue to face challenges and decisions that must be tough. We pray that you are help guiding those decisions. We also continue to pray for all the people out west who have suffered from fires, those who, where there still are fires, and those who lost everything to fires. We pray for those people as well. This morning, I do lift up a joy for earlier this week. We had quite a bit of rain. At the parsonage, we had 4 inches, and everyone around here has told me that it was much needed. So we lift that as a joy, much needed rain. I now will give you a few moments to lift your joys and concerns to the Lord. Let us pray. Lord of hope and healing, you have heard the cries of our hearts. You know that we do want to serve you. And yet, when things get tough, we buckle and we cave in. We lack the courage and strength to work for you. You have reminded us that you will be continually with us, and we need to place our trust in that fact. Your love will sustain and heal us. Your mercy and grace will give us courage and strength, joy, and peace. As we have come before you this day, offering our prayers for those near and dear to us, let us remember that you constantly lift and carry us in your love. Bring us to the knowledge of your mercy and powerful love that will never leave us. Prepare us for ministry in areas of need and desolation. For we ask these things in Jesus' name, and in his name we pray the prayer that he taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our final song this morning from our praise team is going to be I Saw the Light and I Fly Away. Here they are. As we come to the end of our time together, I'd like to share an announcement with everybody. Starting next week, October 4th, we're going to begin worshiping together again. We're going to be worshiping together outside. It's going to be a little bit different, it's going to be unique, and it's going to be an adventure. I hope y'all will join us. Starting at 10 o'clock next Sunday, we'll have our worship service, and because it's the first Sunday of the month, and it's also World Communion Sunday, we will be taking communion together. Very differently, but we're going to be taking communion as well. If you want to bring a lawn chair, you can. If you want to stay in your car, you can. If you want to back up your pickup and sit in the bed of your truck, you can do that as well. We'll be behind the old sanctuary. There'll be more info both online and in the upcoming newsletter that should be mailed out this coming week. I really hope to see some of you there. I also want to let everyone know that if you still are not comfortable coming in that way, that we will still be recording the worship service and putting it online. So it'll just be up later in the afternoon or evening on Sunday. If you can't make it, we hope that you'll still watch us then. As we leave this time together, please hear this benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. I look forward to seeing y'all next week.